If we're lucky, we'll have some rain. If we're lucky, we'll help. But all the talismans from the superstitious past are of no avail if the soil on which the farmer depends has lost the power to grow things. Starvation of the soil occurs in progressive stages. Lush grasses die off and erosion appears. Where natural forest conditions have been destroyed, in dry times the water level drops below the thirsty tree roots. And so we watch as starving trees become spindly and die. Eroding topsoil leaves rocky outcrops on the hills, and in the valley only swamp grass grows. The destruction of the land appears complete. Are we plowing a desert, or is there some life-giving force in this dusty earth? Scientists have spent their lives working to make deserts green again. Millions have been spent at a great store of knowledge gathered on this vital matter. Surely there can be no new approach to the subject. Yet, at Nevallen in North Richmond, New South Wales, there is an Australian who has other ideas on the subject. His experiments in 3 short years threw a mantle of green across the arid landscape. P.A. Yeomans, a mining engineer, is a practical theorist with a belief in the agricultural future of Australia. He is convinced that his methods are the most economical available to the farmer. Looking at Nevallen today, it is hard to believe that on many parts of this property, shale beds were all that was left after bushfires and erosion had done their work. Confronted with this sort of country, any man would be justified in turning his back upon it. To Yeomans, it was a challenge. A sample of the soil to be found on Nevallen 3 years ago is seen around the roots of this fallen tree. Here is the topsoil, such as it was. Here is the subsoil. And completely unchanged, the shale beds that formed the foundation of the area. There are too many scenes like this in the county of Cumberland. The topsoil compacted and poor, wiry grasses and spindly trees the only growing things. There's little to hold the rain when it falls. Future generations must inherit a land that has been nurtured, not impoverished. Yeomans in the earth, if only sunlight, air and moisture can be made to act on it. A valley like this, in a good season, would receive 8 to 10 million gallons of water. The rainfall that should have been a blessing has raged in torrents down the hillside, tearing the good soil from its surface, scouring the eroded channels and racing on to feed that greater menace, the flood. And after a good season, all that is left for the farmer. Science tells us that good pasture will prevent erosion. But is that enough? After 10 inches of rain, this grass is green enough, and there's even some clover. But look at the poor root development. The compacted soil failed to hold even 1 inch of rain. The rest ran away. So Yeoman's task was not only to unlock the goodness in the soil and hold the moisture, but to regenerate its fertility in depth. The method he used has come to be known as the Keyline Plan. To demonstrate exactly what the Keyline Plan is, this is a model of a simple valley. The upper slopes are steep, and the lower slopes tend to flatten out. The point where the steep part starts to flatten out has been named the key point of that valley. From the key point, a true contour or level line is marked. This, then, is the key line of the valley. Well, now, if we look at the valley in section, the locations of the key point and key line become even more apparent. The other contours of the valley, which would be considered a normal contour cultivation, are ignored. The plan of the valley would look like this. This is the steep part of the valley. This is the lower slope. And here is the key line. In practice, this is how the farmer determines the key line of a valley. The point where the valley begins to flatten out is selected by eye. A stake is driven into the ground. This is the key point of the valley. From this point, an accurate contour is set out. In this case, a flexible tube containing water is used. One end of the tube is moved up or down the hillside, and the operators call the readings until the level is established. Markers are placed, and the contour is extended round the hillside. A plough is used to mark for all time the key line of the valley. It is essential that the key line be permanently marked. A band of undisturbed land, a track used as a farm road, or a belt of trees would all serve the purpose. And now we are ready for the first steps in key line cultivation. The key line of the paddock having been permanently established, all cultivation is done parallel to the key line, both above and below it, and normal contours are ignored. Yeomans claims that only during the first cultivation is superphosphate needed. The topsoil is broken up by a chisel-type plough to a depth of 1 inch below the existing root system. During the first or conversion year, the poorest country may need up to 3 cultivations. Each time the ground is worked a little deeper. This was the system followed at Nevalon. And today, the key line of this valley is marked with a pipeline which also serves as a fence. This former shale country is now a picture of plenty. But the story goes deeper than the surface. To show the depth of converted soil, a section of the hillside has been dug out. The chisel-type plough opened up the soil to a depth of 6 inches. The dark color of the topsoil shows that root growth and decay, helped by the cropping of the pasture by cattle, has built up the humus content of the land. Can this be the shale country of 3 years ago? Let's see if there's any shale outcrop left. Here near a fence is some that has been missed by the plough. If we wash the last traces of dirt away, what remains will look pretty poor stuff. But is it? There are major and trace elements in this shale that can be made available to plant life. Where there is moisture in the earth, these elements will be more readily available for plant growth. And here are the results of this absorption fertility. In the green sward, Rhodes grass has taken hold. The roots of cocksfoot and Rhodes grass have gone deep into the friable soil. 4 years ago, it was not considered possible to grow cocksfoot in the county of Cumberland with only natural rainfall. The grasses were sown experimentally with other species and clovers. And here is another remarkable thing. As well as a healthy growth of sown clovers, in the last 2 years, white clover has come in without sowing. This despite expert opinion that white clover would not thrive in the county. These leguminous plants store nitrogen in the nodules on the roots, and this nitrogen becomes available for plant growth. As the pasture is grazed, the humus content is built up in the soil. This natural cycle of growth and decay is the most economic method of increasing the physical fertility of the soil. Another indication of soil fertility is the earthworm count. Earthworms not only increase the aeration of the soil, but they improve the physical condition of the soil. On the Nevalon, in a square foot of this ground, we found up to 12 worm casts. Truly it can be said that when the worm turns, it's a good turn for the farmer. On Nevalon, the land yielded an increased return in the first season, and today the soil is deep and highly fertile. The property has been used exclusively for fattening cattle. Previously it was so poor that 20 head were not able to survive. Today, Nevalon carries a beast to 2 acres, and this figure is improving. Key line also affects the location of storage dams. Because the key point of a valley is the point where the slope begins to flatten out, it is the logical place to build a storage dam. A sudden storm can send up to 500,000 tons of water onto an area of 1,000 acres. Much of this water can be conserved. This key line dam is the smallest of a number of irrigation dams, and it conserves water from the slopes above the dam. An earth wall construction, it holds nearly 4 million gallons. Being high above the main pasture area, This dam is fitted on the down valley side with a 4-inch pipe and gate valve. On the larger dams, 8-inch pipes are used for effective irrigation on all types of country and for complete flood control. Keyline dams are economic because the water is always available under pressure for instant use. Yeomans maintains that for every £100 spent on this type of dam in undulating country, the value of the property is increased by £1,000. As we've seen, the higher the dam, the more economically can the water be used. But the seepage from the upper slopes and storm rainfall must not be lost. So a large dam is usually located near the lowest boundary fence in the valley. These dams are a safety factor in the event of a long drought and should be as deep as possible. With keyline, we know exactly where to place our dams for maximum benefit. Keyline also sets the pattern for tree planting. From the beginning, trees influence the plan of the whole farm. Farm roads can follow the trees on the keyline. Trees form windbreaks where stock find shade in hot weather and warmth in winter. These trees also act as a protection for the pastures. As the stock will only move over the grazing land to feed, the soil is less trampled and compacted. All farmers know that trees have a place on the farm, and keyline provides the plan. Navallan today is a rich and fertile property. This scene of prosperity, framed in a mantle of green, is P.A. Yeoman's reward. His continuous and thorough testing of the keyline plan has brought him into contact with experts in every field of agricultural science. Thousands of people have listened to his story, standing on the very land he has developed. At regular field days, agricultural experts analyze this new approach to land development. Yeomans, having demonstrated the result of his work on Navallan, is anxious to apply keyline principles to the wider field of countryside and river system. He's ready with cold logic and forceful argument to present plans for the benefit of Australia. His critics may not agree wholeheartedly with his theories, but none doubt his sincerity. The hillside lands of Australia generally have the highest rainfall and the poorest soil. If keyline can provide the means to conserve the moisture cheaply and rapidly build up soil fertility, surely it deserves the closest investigation by every thinking person. The Rural Bank, always eager to assist in the advancement of agricultural science and knowledge, is glad on record the principles of the keyline plan.